You know, as long as you understand that we're doing that on the basis that we're trying to be transparent, but not give evidence away that may be used, we'll come back whenever you want us to meetings like this to say, this is where we've got with our enforcement action. So,
just about a matter, what evidence could be used and by whom?
So, the evidence, so we're the regulator, okay? We assess compliance with the code. Conditions that are held by these two companies, and we have to gather evidence as the regulator to inform decisions about the compliance and the enforcement actions. And we have internal governance procedures to consider that information and take decisions about enforcement action and which to would be used. So it's not transparent, you know, it has to be because it's potentially for criminal prosecutions or formal prosecutions.
Yes, sir. And a question here, and then a question from Mary Lockhart, and a question, I'll take James next, and a question over to you. So, yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, this is for the Martin Seaford. Tom Kibbe, on United Union Scots Executive. Here, sort of, gathering information as a part of an organisation called Frack or Fight. They're very interested in what the oil and gas industry is doing in Fight. And I have to say, before I ask my question, is all our workings with SEPA actually proved that SEPA's a pretty toothless lion, to be honest, and is very ineffectual. But what I would like to ask is, how many visits have SEPA actually carried out to Moss Morton prior to this? Over a year. How many inspections have they carried out? Did you visit on more than one occasion during the flare that just happened? How many improvement notices or prohibition notices or enforcement notices have actually been put in place in Moss Morton over the last 10 years, say? And as for community engagement, surely a facility like Moss Morton that's on the doorsteps of communities, there should be community engagement with SEPA through the communities on an ongoing basis.
Yes.
Since the place started, not just when an unplanned event happens, because that appears to be all that happens. They have an unplanned event, SEPA does its thing, nothing happens, and to threaten Moss Morton with a £40,000 fine, it's kind of laughable, to be honest. It needs more than that. There should be improvement notices, and the communities deserve to know what those improvement notices were and what actions are going to be taken to ensure that the improvement notices work and it never happens again. That's what the people are sitting here for. That's what they want to hear.
Questions there, and they're all valid. I don't necessarily have the answers to them all. I'm sorry, I'm not the site inspector. I said that, I'm not the guy who actually visits. So normally, an installation or installations of this type would be visited at least 4 to 6 times a year by SEPA, but more frequently, depending on the findings of those visits. All of the inspections that we carry out are published. They're on our website. All the information associated with the findings of those inspections are published on our website. So I can provide a link to those if you want to go and have a look. In terms of how these companies are assessed, they're assessed under a compliance assessment scheme. And that information is published too on our website. So, and the companies, they are permitted, they are allowed under their permit to flare, okay? Because of safety reasons, and they could, if they were here, they could explain why, but they're not, and I can't explain in the terms that they would why, but they are for safety reasons. And I have to flare. They should be telling us about unplanned flaring of certain types, the volumes, and nature, and they're obliged to produce reports on the back of it. So, in terms of improvement notices, I'm not aware of any having been issued, but we are in regular dialogue. We write to the operator, and those letters are made publicly available. So, did we visit during the flaring? We were out, we were in people's backyards, we were trying to, you know, assess the information as it was emerging, and we've been clearly in touch with other authorities about what was happening and the operators. So, you know, I can answer those questions in that sense. Yes, we were there, and it's ongoing.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Obviously, CBAC can't grow its own teeth, so you might want to ask the politicians here what they plan to do if extra teeth are needed. Yes, sir.
Well, my guy, we tend to present virtually as a line of sight for each monitor where we actually stay, along with other residents in Mackenzie Crescent Pass that are here tonight. Question I'd like to direct towards CEPA, but also to a man that's not really said very much here, which is Vice Council, because I think both of these have responsibility here, is that if you could set up a range of penalties towards what's wrong, and I'm going from improvement notices to various fines, etc., then how are we able to find out, since the inception of the plan, how many of these improvement notices have actually taken place? So that follows on the point of my friend at the back there from the union, effectively saying, where do we find this information out? What communications have actually happened? But more importantly, from one perspective, I work in financial services as a contractor, and every time I move from place to place, I have to go through a set of inductions that tell me how important it is to do this, that, and whatever, to protect the CEOs of the company, because they're the last people that want to get called up into court. So the one thing I never heard you turn around and say there when you said a range of penalties was that you would actually have the Exxon or Shell Managing Director called into court to actually answer the questions of what's actually going on in this plan. So we need to understand the regulations that SEPA have got. I have the actors list of what can we do to actually make SEPA give the SEPA these powers to be able to do that statutory wise.
So, I described the range of penalties earlier, and the £40,000 was quoted. That was a civil sanction that we can directly apply. It's just in the mix of the tool, it's the toolkit we've got. The range of penalties, I mean, you know, so there are directly applied penalties that we can impose, but actually, if it's through the court, it's through the court system, and there are maximum specified levels of penalties that apply to particular offences and imprisonment potentially as well. So who's liable or who's the target of that enforcement is a key issue, is a legal issue, and I don't have the answer because we have to go in pursuit of the responsible person. Now, who is the responsible person in ExxonMobil would be a very, very key question for us to get legal advice on. So, you know, clearly you're not at that stage yet, but, you know, we regularly undertake enforcement actions, you know, between 30 and 40 prosecutions actually go through the Scottish courts each year. So, you know, we're used to gathering evidence to the standard at which we'll actually get a successful prosecution. So if we end up there, we find out who it is we go for and, you know, what instrument we use. I think you made a really good point about the level at which this conversation might happen for an organisation like CEPA, because, you know, we deal at the site level and we deal with the safety, health and environment kind of folk within the businesses there. They're the people who talk the language, understand the process. That's where the relationship exists at a site level. And I said earlier we're trying to create an independent investigatory team in order to sort of come in and bear scrutiny on that and make sure that we sort of look at the information from a different place. But, you know, how do we escalate that dialogue is an important one. And, you know, I'll take it back from this meeting to our, you know, chief exec and senior exec team and say, this is the feeling from this meeting. You know, perhaps we should be intervening at a more senior level about these kind of incidents, and we can give it a go. And our chief exec is very much behind that type of interaction with companies. So I think it's a really good idea. I will play it back in to CEPA.
Thanks, Kenny, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, from a fight against perspective, I'm going to point out in terms of the enforcement.
side of things, that SEPA are the regulatory authority for the installation. However, Fife Council set up this, the Independent Air Quality Monitoring Review Group was set up to provide recommendations to Fife Council regarding such issues as the recent flaring incident. So what we've arranged for is a special meeting of the Musselburgh and Braithwaite Bay Independent Air Quality Monitoring Review Group later this month, at which all the issues, including from this meeting tonight, will be discussed. And in terms of how, as we've discussed, can maybe improve communications with the local community regarding these air quality issues.
Can I ask a wrong question? Is that the director, please?
Okay, stand up and ask it. Very quickly.
Okay, so Fife Council have been around for 100 years. Uh-huh. This morning has been around for 25 years. Uh-huh. Why is this conversation just going to happen next week or next month? Surely this conversation should have been had 17 years ago or other.
Well, the conversation with the Musselburgh and Braithwaite Bay group to discuss these particular issues and produces a report. And also, if there's any issues emerging, then we'll convene meetings to try and discuss these. And an annual report is produced each year. And that's to satisfy ourselves and also satisfy, we submit reports to both the Scottish Government and satisfy them that the relevant air quality objectives are being achieved.
Okay, but this is only about air quality. You'll find out later tonight.
Right.
There's a range of issues, not just specific.
When it comes to those long term.
I represent a ward which is bang in the heart of the area that is regularly and has been regularly affected both by the flaring and the burn-off which has been polluting specifically in the burn-off from Musselburgh since 1985. And in fact I have a history here because my mother was a Lithgow Thermal District Councillor and was one of the first people to lead a campaign against the pollutants that were coming out of Musselburgh. And the answer that she got then is the answer that we've all been getting now, which is that actually it's harmless. We shouldn't be worried about it, we shouldn't be agitated about it. And report after report has been done. Now the health reports that have come out have all highlighted real concerns that are health impact. But always the focus in the end is on the pollutant and the air quality impact. What we haven't had, and what's really difficult about all this right now, is that, I think it was Karen who said early on, the people have lost confidence in every single agency apart from the campaign group from Lochgelly in this matter. So the people do not believe that the independent review group set up by Fife Council is independent. How can, now this is a question, how can a review group be independent when its representatives are the Air Quality Monitoring Body, the Health and Safety Body, the representatives of Exxon, Shell and Mobil? Unless Mr. Bissett has an explanation of how that can be independent, I'm sorry, I don't see how it's independent. I have some specific questions for SEPA, which actually relate to what has been happening so far. And really these are, when that flaring was happening, what measurements were taken and from what levels? Were they taken on the site? Were they taken in the air? Were they taken, you said you were in backyards, in people's backyards. Where were these backyards? Were they in Kelty? Were they in Mullingry? Were they in Lochgelly? At which end of Lochgelly, north or south? I accept that you cannot give detail because it's tantamount to a judicial process, if you like. But where were these measurements taken? How frequently and how many of them? What was your database from which you proposed to go on? So I did want to ask you that specific question. And I'm sorry, Chair, but I'm likely to have other questions as we go on, but I'm sure there are others.
Thank you very much.
Data and that data will be, the subject of the independent air quality review group consideration later this month. So Yeah, but also to clarify here, this was an unplanned event, okay? That's how it's described by the companies. It's an upset of the system, all that. So this was not scheduled. We could not line up air quality monitoring in response to incidents like this across Scotland. We're just not resourced to be able to deliver that kind of response. So our focus is on the processes and the systems and the accreditation of the plant's operations at the site as the first point in our investigations, if you like. So, you know, and similarly with noise, I know. So where were people? Ian Brobbelbank, my colleague, could have told you exactly where he went because he said to me before he went on leave that he actually sat with somebody in their backyard and experienced it, okay? So, and made it very, very clear to me what the impacts were around vibrations, noise, you know, and the real genuine concern and worry about the black smoke. So, you know, that is partly what a good regulator should and could do, is just do that as part of the response. I can't say exactly where, because it was Ian who did that work. So I'm probably not adding very much in the way of detail, but you know, if we'd been warned about this as a scheduled planned flaring incident, we could have deployed air quality monitoring. But it wasn't. And none of us knew how long it was going to go on for, and none of us really knew how best to deploy the plant type of incident.
Thank you very much. Take James next. I've got two down here, one here and one here after James.
I was just to address, see the one other question asked that was going on. In 2016, SEPA were informed there was going to be 3-week flaring. And an earlier report from SEPA showed that noise levels had been breached at one resident's property. So we'd been pushing, and we'd go residents together, but happily going to open up the homes for noise data and be better during that period. Unfortunately, during that time, for whatever reason, SEPA required 3 weeks noise monitoring, even though they were told when the flaring was going to begin and when the flaring was going to end. We were informed later on that SEPA did do some intermittent monitoring rather than check in with how these residents had been set up in Upper Tool and Logelli, and then that there was potential there for noise levels to be breached depending on how much volume was flared off. And then one of the things that they were going to do was then push for Moss Moor and ExxonMobil were to do independent monitoring, and SEPA were also going to do their own noise monitoring, and then they can compare the data to see if it correlates. However, with this recent event that lasted 9 days, was there any noise monitoring conducted? Because we keep going back to the quality that there isn't absolute noise, vibration, light, and he seems to be monitoring as well. The quality is regarding workers.
So there have been assessments done of noise, and there is a report that's available, and some of the findings of that report we actually have outlined to local politicians and will be available on our website. So the real difficulty that we have is actually getting people out at the time that there's a flaring incident occurring. Now, I know this went on for a long time, but I'll make the point, as I made earlier, we don't have the flexibility and resource necessarily to just deploy noise monitoring in response. So, you know, we have done some pre-planned stuff. We will publish a report. You know, if what we hear tonight is, you should be doing it, we accept that. And I play that back into the organisation again. Ian Brockerbank, I know, takes this seriously. And, you know, again, let's not forget the operator here has an obligation to demonstrate compliance with their permit. Okay? I know you want the regulator to go and prove stuff, and clearly we need to do that, but we will focus on the operations at the site and the information that supports you know, how they operated at that particular time, and that's the focus of our investigation. The companies themselves you know, have to demonstrate compliance, and I have to show some willingness. So I know there's a conversation to be had with the companies about noise monitoring generally, and that is ongoing, because they can employ contractors to undertake this kind of work on call-off contracts, you know, to deploy people in, you know, circumstances when they know they're flaring, and to give a perspective on how serious that noise is. It's an enormously complicated area, there's noise, and I know there's so much sensitivity, not just how you measure it, but how people experience it and quantifying it. So we have to apply standard techniques, and it's quite tricky. It isn't just a question of going out. It's really quite sophisticated measuring equipment and modelling techniques. So if we need to do more of it, we listen and hear that. But actually, let's not forget the operator too.
Can I ask you a question? Do you think that Shell and Exxon will opt in here tonight?
That's a question for them, not me, to be honest. Well, they're not here to express the view, and I mean, you've given them the opportunity to.
Yes, sir.
To be honest, I've come here tonight and I'm open mind. I'm quite appalled that you're actually supposed to be protecting us. For one thing, the person that's supposed to be looking after the plant is on holiday. I take that. But it seems to be by committee. Everything's done by committee. It's people that have been affected by this. It's not committees. The people from the committees can live out with the area. They're not getting the rumbling ground and the lights through. And no one is contacting the residents. No one is asking for our opinion. You pass it on to SEPA, yeah, okay. And then the next thing, you don't hear anything from SEPA. That's must want to put out the standard apology. Fife Council, they're relying on SEPA. Why has Fife Council never came round the streets and asked the residents? And it's all about air quality. You have a duty of care for the residents. You have a duty of care. And under that, if there's health and safety issues, such as noise, light, that can affect mental health, it can affect a variety of things. So it's not just air quality you should be concerned about, it's the whole thing. And for the people that are represented, I'm not casting names or anything like that, I would be interested to find out the hospitality that's been received for the members. Sometimes. I'd be interested in getting a Freedom of Information Act from each of the parties.
Well, let me make you that's something you can organise. I suspect you can't answer because you have to go through the system. But if anyone here is prepared to answer such a question, then feel free.
Hold on a second.
Just one second. James has an answer,
then
we'll take
Councillor. There has been an issue long term in gifts and corporate hospitality, and I do think that's one of the areas where it's created mistrust between the committees. The minutes for 2016 show Community Council's raised no issues, but on 18 separate occasions, Dan, ExxonMobil, and Shell for the offer of gifts. That seems unbalanced to me. We had the 3-week flare. It caused quite a lot of concern, not only in the our local area, but across Edinburgh. So there is an issue here. I would like to state not all community councillors take gifts, not all councillors take gifts. But I've got to be fair. When I was on the Musselmore Great Group Day Committee, I served for a year. I'd raised the issue of the cancer rates, and I had a community councillor that I met in the area tell me that there was an issue for Lagelli. And within 2 seconds, he was thanking for a gift away to the rugby match, Six Nations match. So it was difficult getting issues tackled. And because there is something to do with gifts, they will create difficulties in getting some of the issues addressed. And one of the problems with that committee is the minutes are not publicly available. The meetings are held behind closed doors. You're not allowed to attend these meetings. You can only get these minutes by freedom of information. 2015, they agreed that these minutes would be published publicly, but there's never been a great effort to make sure that are available in the public domain. So any minutes that do suffer, as I see that, because an individual community council's put them out and it's somewhere up on the internet, or it's on the Facebook freedom information, and that's one issue that does need to be tackled. Councillors and community councillors, every representative should stand up and decline any future gifts, and declare what gifts have been offered, as far as I'm concerned, and decline any future gift, and make it clear publicly to the plan operators and to residents that gifts are unacceptable any more than this.
I just wanted to say that all the
councillors
have to declare any gifts that they receive, and so the community council and Fife Council publishes it on its website, so you can scrutinise anything that your councillor has had ever from anybody on that website. On a personal note, I declined hospitality from Exxon, but I did request that they let me have a bowl of soup and a sandwich in the canteen so that I could discuss local employment issues with them. They didn't keep me up on the road.
Thank you very much. You have to be clear, though, I assume, Councillor Robert, you can't do your job unless you get a chance to visit the site, etc. So site visits are entirely acceptable.
Yes.
A number of things, but first of all, I want to address the minutes are available on Fife Council website, I believe. I haven't actually checked. I will tonight. Hospitality. I receive a diary every year, and I have done for the last 10 years from ExxonMobil. It's a
84.
It's a very small pocket diary.
So are you alone in getting one?
No, I believe all the councillors in the area receive a diary from ExxonMobil.
I've never received any from
Alec, for the last 3 or 4 years you've been a councillor for Ward 7, the Lochs, which is not in the area that receives diaries, I understand. Cowdenbeath councillors receive a diary and have done for 10 years.
I think we're wasting our time on the diaries.
Right, okay. We're talking.
People might not necessarily want to wait until you see something on the website.
Okay.
And you could obviate that if members of the public were available could access the meetings. Is there a problem with that?
I think the only issue would be that I don't think ESSO and ExxonMobil would want members of the public at the meeting. How many members of the public would like to go to the monthly, the quarterly meeting?
Can you back and actually come up to them, please?
Hold on a second.
I've been to one meeting. I can tell you that the community councils are represented by the chairs of the community councils. CEPA are represented. And there's the councillors from the area are represented at those meetings. If anybody wants to put anything forward to those meetings, you have got 15 councillors in the area, taking in the 4 wards that cover Musselburgh. You've got 9, I believe, community councils in the area. You have got all of those people you can go to and ask for questions to be put in. And if you want to, ask your councillors for a copy of the minutes. They can be made available. It's not an issue. They're also available on the council website, I do believe. Again, if not, they're on the Shell and Exxon websites. Again, I believe I will check again tonight. But there's no reason to not have this information. It is freely available.
And that would extend to visits to the Edinburgh to 2.
I believe
the ExxonMobil invited members to the Edinburgh Tattoo.
I have never heard of any Edinburgh not in the 10 years that I've been a councillor. In
fact, thank you. A question for you. I'll take you a second, sir. Just a question for you.
My name's Mark Russell, I'm a Green Party MSP committee, so I'm advising